some information about the shooter besides just the name has come out, including things that make the fact that this mass violence was able to happen seem even more difficult to comprehend, including the fact that he appears to have been arrested last year, accused of engaging in a lengthy standoff with the police after threatening to hurt his mother with a homemade bomb. He was charged with several crimes, including felony menacing and three kidnapping charges. It's unclear whom he was accused of kidnapping. Apparently, the mother wasn't with him at the time. And in the end, apparently, they're saying he didn't have a bomb. So I guess it's all cool, the fact that there are red flag laws that are supposed to stop people like this from getting things like AR-15 style rifles. Didn't happen, and so he was able to get a weapon that allowed him to kill more people. One other interesting fact about his background is that apparently, according to the best information we have right now, he is the grandson of a California Republican assemblyman. You can see him here, and with that image, I think that you understand everything you need to know about this individual. That's Randy Vopel, who represents California's 71st Assembly District. And
Eagle tie is a choice.
The eagle tie is certainly a choice, as well as the hat at this point. But anyway, also said 3 days after the January 6th insurrection, this is Lexington and Concord, first shots fired against tyranny. And look, on the one hand, you are in no way responsible for what your grandparents do. I had one grandparent who was awesome. Great guy, very charitable, one of the best influences on me ever. I have another grandparent who I have vague memories of him saying racist stuff at dinner once, and I decided at a very young age I was never going to have anything to do with him. So you're not responsible for what your grandparents do. But also, his grandparent was an elected Republican politician who was big on the whole MAGA and revolution thing. So it's certainly something to look into. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, there are a number of influences out there in society, and not enough influences that, well, there are influences out there that provoke trans violence, and not enough influences that are anti-trans violence, right? Like, that's what I'm trying to say here, because I remember during the George Floyd protest, there was a big emphasis on, it's not enough to just say, oh no, I don't like racism. You have to be anti-racist. When you see racism happening in society, whether it's in media or in discourse or in person, you're supposed to call it out because it's a dangerous thing. It leads to violence. It provokes stereotypes, et cetera, et cetera. You need to have a similar thing with trans and LGBTQ, like all this panic as well. When the conservative side says that, look, these trans people, they're having, or not even trans people, just like gay people or lesbian people, whatever, people who don't fall under the standard binary, when they have drag queen story hour, or when they just simply exist and have bars or have events, like, this is dangerous. And not only is it dangerous, it's grooming children. It's against your morality. It's coming for your kids, right? It's scaring them. It's mutilating them, as some people like Matt Walsh uses. And so when you're using that rhetoric, it amps people up. It makes them feel like, oh, this is a matter of life and death. They're harming kids. They're coming for my kids, potentially, the kids in my neighborhood. So when that rhetoric is happening, it's incumbent on not just people on the left, and there have been far too few people on the left who have been emphasizing this. In fact, a lot of people on the left who have been coddling folks like Joe Rogan, who constantly spread this trans panic out all over the media. But you don't even have liberals, like regular people in office, like standing up to say, no, this trans panic stuff is ridiculous. This is the same stuff they've tried over and over again in the culture war from the 90s and the 2000s. Joe Biden, I think, has been fairly forceful with it, but he can only do so much and say so much as a person. Like, you need Democratic politicians top to bottom vehemently talking against this stuff, because it's out there and people have been warning that it's going to lead to violent acts like this. Yeah. This is the result, and this is America, so it's only going to continue.
Yeah, I mean, we've been, how many times have we said this over the course of this year and last year? Like, that this is inevitably where it's going to go. And we've gotten, you know, bits of it. There have been threats, and there have been attacks, and there's been Molotov cocktails, and now there's also
hospital bombings, like, so, yeah. threats of it.
Yeah. Yeah. And every step of the way, every single escalation, the people inspiring the stochastic terrorism are out saying, well, how dare you? have a problem with these threats. These threats don't mean anything. What, in fact, it was probably you that did the threats. You probably called in the threats against the hospital. It was probably a trans person that did this attack. I haven't seen them saying it yet. Just wait and see.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.